Hi everyone and welcome to Scuba Diver magazine. I'm Mark, a British dive instructor, and in today's video is going to follow on with our scuba diving basics playlist, teaching you all of the things that you need to know when you're just starting out as a brand new shiny scuba diver. So today's video is all about top tips for when you're just starting out, so you can save yourself some money or just make your life a little bit easier on the dive boat. So now's the time to take a moment to learn a little something and research a few tips and tricks that may not be immediately obvious. So I started out elaborating on all of these tips, thinking I was only going to do 5, but I just kept thinking of other tips. So these are actually going to be 25 quickfire tips to try and download as many obscure tips out of my brain as possible. If you need us to elaborate on any of these in particular, then let us know down in the comments below. If you're into your scuba diving, then don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the Scuba Diver magazine channel so you'll see more just like this. Anyway, let's get started. I think all of the experienced divers watching will all agree that the most annoying thing can happen on a dive is when you're actually all kitted up right at the beginning. You've got your heavy tank on your back and your fins on your feet, and you've left your mask in your box on the floor over there. So now you have to awkwardly waddle over on a pitching boat, bend down to get your mask, and then summon the strength in your legs to actually stand back up again. Before you even get into your wetsuit, do a head-to-toe checklist of your gear and place it somewhere convenient that you can reach whilst you're standing upright. If you jump into your wetsuit or dry suit first before everybody else, then you're just going to get all hot and tired just sorting everything out. Another handy thing to remember is to remember to untie your tank before you put your BCD on. If you're diving off a boat, then most tanks will actually be secured in place with a rope or a weight belt strap. This stops your tank and BCD from falling over, but it also stops you from standing up if you forget to undo that knot. Also, remember to turn your gas on. Your pressure gauge might actually say that it's full, but it doesn't mean that your gas is actually turned on. It just means that it was turned on and the regulators are still pressurized. So you'll only get sort of 2 or 3 breaths out of it. If you're struggling to get your regulators off of your tank after a dive, then chances are there's still a little bit of pressure inside them. Press that purge button a couple more times, and if you still can't get it off, then turn the body of the first stage a little bit. It can loosen the grip. If you're diving in colder waters where you need a hood, then bring 2 or as many as you have. Most cold water wetsuits and dry suits come with a complimentary hood, so you end up collecting them, and instead of leaving your second or third hood, bring it with you. You can now put on a nice fresh dry hood for your second dive instead of a cold, damp, nasty hood. Every diver needs at least 1 cutting device to get them out of trouble in the water, and while most dive knives are made from marine grade steel, it can still rust if you don't keep it clean. Your dive knife won't rust during the dive itself, but after the dive when it's left wet and exposed to the fresh air. If you coat the blade with a little bit of silicone grease, it helps keep the water off. After the dive, give it a good rinse off with fresh water and then let it dry properly. Leave the camera, take the dive computer. I know the reef is a beautiful place that you want to share with everyone you know and everyone that follows you on Instagram, but I promise you when you're just starting out, a camera will make your dive profile look like a heart rate monitor. Until you can manage your buoyancy without looking, a camera will just draw your attention way too much and you will naturally hold your breath a little so you actually float up and have a bad day. Leave the camera. the best way to become a better scuba diver is to get in the water as much as possible. Even if you're just diving in a swimming pool once a week, you're working on your buoyancy and your comfort in the water. You're also gaining experience with dive equipment, how it works and how to adjust it. That way, when you're on a dive boat and the Kanban doesn't fit quite properly, it's not a big deal. You know roughly how much lead to wear because you've played about with your weighting before. You just need to adjust for any change in equipment or water. Joining a club doesn't just give you experience though, it can give you invitations. Clubs will have trips running throughout the year and you can quickly build up your experience and confidence with a safe group. Too many divers just cruise around unaware of their surroundings. They end up bumping into other divers, or worse, the coral. Before going in to take a look at something, just take a quick glance around at your surroundings and the divers around you so you know roughly where everything is, so that you don't bump into them. Take notice of any water current or sort of water movement too, because if you're not paying attention, the water will just push you into something. If you want to avoid being caught out in current, watch the fish ahead of you. If you look at these little guys, they start off right out there in the water column, but as a dash of current starts up, they all duck down, and notice how they're all swimming in the same direction? If they're just ambling around far from the reef, then the water is pretty still with little current. If they're all close to the reef and swimming in the same direction but not really going anywhere, then there's current ahead. These bright little fish are called antheases, and they are usually the best indicators for current. Look around once in a while whilst you're in the water. Sometimes we kind of get tunnel vision and can only focus on what's in front of you on the reef, and you can totally miss that giant whale shark just cruising past you because you never look out into the blue. Big things are silent underwater. You won't hear them coming unless they're a pod of dolphins or something, and turning around can actually help you keep in contact with the group and, of course, your buddy. A really easy way to get separated is when one of you swims on whilst the other stops to look at something. You can often come across peer pressure when scuba diving, and this isn't when a peer is trying to make you do something, but when another diver suggests that you do something that you may not be comfortable with. There is absolutely no situation in which you are obligated to go on any dive if you don't want to. If you don't like a certain part of the dive plan, or if you just don't feel like you're up to it, then stand up and just say, "I'm sorry, but I don't feel comfortable." It's far better to just skip the dive or change the dive plan. If there's anything that you are unsure about, then just ask and try to do it as early as possible. If you turn your gas on and it only reads 50 bar, then we can usually do something about it as long as you tell us early enough. But if you leave it until the last minute, then you might not be going on that dive. Or worse, you keep quiet about it and you actually go on that dive with very little gas. So silly little things can turn into big problems underwater, so it's best to voice any concerns as soon as you find them. No one's going to think any less of you, but you might learn something for the next time. It's good to recognize these sort of little signs ahead of the time. The underwater world is a bit different to dry land, so you can get turned around really easily and get lost if you don't pay attention. Before you go on a dive, look for a map of the dive site and take it all in, including which way is north. Before a dive, I take a good long look at a map of the area and take note on a slate of any landmarks so that at any point when I reach a particular area, I know roughly where I am and which way to go because I can visualize myself on that map. If there are no landmarks or you just can't see them, then a compass will make your life much easier to navigate. If you know that your boat is moored up to the north point of the reef or the sun was on your right hand side when you jumped in, then you'll have better luck at making it back to the boat at the end of the dive. it is easy to get caught up in the dive and forget to check your gauges. You then look down and you're way low on gas. So I like to check my gauges after I see anything interesting. That way I'm checking my gauges all of the time. The more frequently you check your gauges, the easier it is to recognize a fault, and you shouldn't be surprised by your tank pressure. If your tank pressure suddenly drops a chunk, then you might have a leak that's developed underwater. If you're checking your gauges all the time, then you'll never find yourself in the red, and you'll always know roughly how much gas you have left. I've seen some divers out there end their dives on zero tank pressure because they think they've paid for every last puff of air in that tank, but it's there for a reason. At 5 meters depth, two divers can manage a decent safety stop breathing simultaneously from one tank. If you're selfish and you go into the red, then you both have to cut your stop short, which can be dangerous. You're also pretty useless if there's a missing diver with no gas on your tank. All you can really do is just act as surface support. A spare bolt snap is a multifunctional tool. I dive with plenty of bolt snaps to keep my dive gear clipped off onto me, but a spare bolt snap is really useful. It can obviously replace one that you've dropped, but a bolt snap can also be used as a signaling device. Sound travels really well underwater. If you just need your buddy to turn around, flicking the action a couple of times is nice and clear, and if you need something louder, just bop it against your tank. That's good and loud. BCDs are designed to hold you in a horizontal position in the water, but small pockets of air can get trapped in corners of the bladder, and in the wrong position, it doesn't matter how hard you can push that button, you will never get that gas out unless you can move that trapped air to the valve itself. Visualize where the valve is behind you and make that the highest point so the air trapped inside moves up to it, then you can get rid of it. If you've ever given the choice of a cabin on a liveaboard, then go for as high up as you can. Lower decks can get quite stuffy, and they usually have polished wooden staircases down to them. Hard enough to navigate when they're still, let alone when the boat is actually moving. Upper decks are also safer if something bad should happen. It's far easier to get out of your cabin and it's generally nicer. You're further away from the engine and the compressor, so it's quieter, and the extra fresh air is better if you suffer from seasickness. A lot of divers actually carry their pillows and blankets to the top deck and sleep up there in the open air if they're in hot climates. When you start to dive, you're usually loaded up with just way too much lead. There's a few reasons for this, but as you venture out into the big blue ocean by yourself, you'll often find that you can drop quite a lot of that lead. When you reach your maximum depth on a dive, if you need any more than just a couple small squirts of gas to get neutral, then you're just wearing too much lead. Too much lead will increase your air consumption, it also makes your buoyancy far more volatile, and lead's just heavy. If you're deeper than everyone else in the group, then you're breathing gas faster than everybody else, and you'll be the first to end the dive. By staying a little bit shallower than everyone else, your air will actually last much longer. You're on-gassing less, and you get to see everything that everyone else sees. So trust me, deeper water is just colder and darker. If there's nothing to see there, then stay a little bit shallower. You should only really need to buy one primary mask in your career, so make it a good one. Don't think too much on the colour or any fancy detailing you may have seen, concentrate on the fit itself. So spend some time with your local dive centre, look up online what brands they can actually get in for you and what range of masks suit you best on the manufacturer's website. The dive centre might not actually have the mask that suits you best in the stock at that moment, but they might be able to order it in for you. So it's important to know if any alternates exist. And invest in a surface marker buoy. They are a very important piece of safety equipment, and a lot of places actually require all divers to have one now. And it's good to learn how to use one early in your career, so if you don't have one, get one. If there's one thing that I'm meticulous about before a dive, it's cleaning my feet. One piece of grit or sand in your boot will really ruin your day and the next day. Before every dive, shake out your boots and dust off your feet. And if you're diving in a dry suit, make sure that your socks are on properly. You can't pull them up in the water. With the repetitive movements that we do, our feet are on a dive can quickly develop sores. Sunscreen is good for preventing sunburn, but many sunscreens can actually kill coral. Most rash vests will have a UPF rating and are made to protect you even when wet. They don't just protect you from sunburn though. Rash vests will also protect you from a lot of marine stings, rubbing from your BCD, and also bumps and scrapes in the water, so they're a great investment. We are biologically programmed to recognize faces, but you can't always see everybody's face on a dive. One of the most distinguishable features of a diver is their fins. Fins come in countless shapes and colors, and it's rare that on a dive boat you'll see too many duplicates. Take note of what your guide is wearing and what your buddy is wearing. That way you won't go off following a complete stranger. Just bear in mind that colors change the deeper down you go, so those red fins on the boat will be a kind of dull brownish color underwater. Staying well hydrated is very important to staying healthy. If you're dehydrated, then you are more susceptible to decompression sickness. But avoid alcohol. It can be very dangerous to mix alcohol and scuba diving, so just avoid it. But also plan your drinks accordingly, especially when you're dry suit diving. Being submerged in water actually makes your body need to pee, so it's not so bad when you're in a wetsuit, but in a dry suit, after a long or cold dive, your first instinct is usually to warm yourself up with a hot shower, hands on a radiator, or a good hot drink. It's important that you don't rush this, unfortunately, because quickly warming yourself up has shown to increase your chances of decompression illness in that specific area. Your body is pretty clever, just let it do its thing. All you have to do is just get yourself dry, get out of any wind or rain, and let your body do the rest. Don't try and speed up the process. When I get on a dive boat, I tend to make myself at home, only I tend to put things down and then forget where I put them. Liveaboards are the worst for this because they usually have lots of little places to put things, but try and discipline yourself. You'll be given a box to keep all of your gear secure and do your best to put it back in there. It's also crucial not to leave any electronics charging unattended. With an increase in rechargeable stuff, it can actually overload the wiring in some boats, which is very dangerous. So never leave anything charging if you're going to leave the room. If you do need to leave the room, just unplug it. Okay, so there are just a few tips that I can think of, but there are plenty more of them rattling around up here, so stay tuned for a part two one of these days. If you've come across any handy tips, then let everyone know them down in the comments below. If you found this video useful, then take a moment to click that little thumbs up button. I'll wait. Cool, thank you. And of course, subscribe to the Scuba Diver Magazine channel for more videos like this. Thank you for watching, and of course, safe diving.